Well, was it to me first? Well, in that case, I can start with a compliment to Dinesh, because in one of his books, he tells the story of asking his father in India, "Daddy, everyone around here seems to be Hindu, with quite a few Muslims. Why are we Christians?" And his father said, "Because, Dinesh, my lad, the Portuguese Inquisition got to this part of India first." Which is, in fact, the full and complete explanation for that.
Actually,
so you can tell Dinesh was very well brought up in this respect, and he's made the most of it. Obviously, in my case, this does not apply because, I mean, obviously, if you ask someone in Buffalo, why did you go to the Roman Catholic Church, he'll say, because my parents were from Poznan. It's the overwhelmingly probable explanation. Why did you go to a Greek Orthodox Church? My parents were born in Thessaloniki. Of course, this is true, but there are a lot of people who convert. In fact, quite a large number of Muslims on their way out of Islam embrace Christianity, which is a very risky thing to do. It must be something they care a lot about, and I think one should take seriously. And though it was relatively easy for me, being born in England and emigrating to America, to leave the Church of England behind, that, believe me, is no sweat. our great religious poet, our great Christian poet, George Herbert, refers to the sweet mediocrity of our native church. What do you get if you cross an Anglican with the Jehovah's Witness? Someone who comes to your door and bothers you for no particular reason. So, enough from me.
Well, I think we have an environmental explanation for Christopher's skepticism. He was raised in a religion that was based on the family values of Henry VIII. Enough said. Now, with regard to the Indian explanation, his explanation is true but incomplete. And here's the point. My grandfather did say that to me, and I began to read Indian history. And I realized that a handful of Portuguese missionaries, inquisitorial or not, would have a pretty hard time converting hundreds of thousands of people. And Indian historians who look at it have a better explanation. It's called the caste system. See, if you were born into the Hindu caste system and you were one of the guys on the lower rungs of the ladder, to put it somewhat bluntly, you were screwed. It didn't matter what merit you had, you couldn't rise up, and neither could your children. So along come these greedy missionaries, and maybe they had swords, but the truth of it is a lot of Indians were very eager to get out of the caste system. They didn't need the swords. They rushed into the arms of the missionaries because they promised something that the Hindus couldn't, universal brotherhood. It wasn't always practiced, but even the idea of it, the principle of it, was hugely appealing. And that's why there were mass conversions not only to Christianity, but also to Islam, which makes a similar promise. So this is the historical landscape. A final point about this is that we're committing here what could be called a genetic fallacy. We do it with religion. We always can see the fallacy if we apply it to any other area. For example, it is very probable that there are more people who believe in Darwin's theory of evolution who come from Oxford, England, than who come from Oxford, Mississippi. It's probably equally true that there are more people who believe in Einstein's theory of relativity who come from New York than who come from New Guinea. What does this say about whether Einstein's theory is correct or no? Nothing. The origins of your ideas have no bearing on whether they're true or not. So wherever Christopher and I got our ideologies or our religious convictions, you should weigh our arguments on the merits. Thank you.
Thank you both.
Mr. De Souza, you mentioned that you would only speak basically in secular terms, in terms of defending your faith without appealing to revelation or anything of that sort. Do you feel that there is an advantage for the world population at large for religious people to be required to defend their faith in such a venue, or do you feel that we would be better off if you had the luxury of only defending your faith within congregations of the faithful and without counterpart skeptics to demand that sort of intellectual line?
I've argued that I think that Christians need to learn to be bilingual. And by that I mean to speak perhaps two languages, a Christian language at home or in church, and a more secular language in the public square. Not because we want to wear two faces, but because we want to make our arguments accessible to people who may not share our assumptions. And so a lot of times, if someone says, you know, what do you think about gay marriage? The Christian opens to the book of Leviticus, not recognizing that the person he's talking to does not recognize the authority of Leviticus to decide the matter. So it becomes a futile enterprise, two ships in the night. The only way to have debate is to meet on some common ground. And in that sense, I think in a democratic society, the common ground of reason is a perfectly appropriate language for democratic discourse. So what we're doing here is a secular intellectual enterprise. If I was speaking, as I sometimes do, in a megachurch or at a Catholic event, I might speak in a little different language, but that's because I'm speaking to an audience with different assumptions.
My name's Ian.
No, no, it was for dinner.
I'm Ian from the Michiana Skeptics. My question is for Dinesh. Christopher, you kind of addressed this already. It's on the issue of spontaneous generation. Dinesh, you used the analogy with the jet being spontaneously put together by a thunderstorm, you know, in a junkyard of sorts. I was wondering, how do you defend the argument that it's more likely that a creator did this when, you know, even though it's unlikely that, say, something would have randomly created a cell or a molecule over time. There's still in the infinite spans of things, in the vast amount of time that the universe has existed, some minuscule probability that this could have come about versus this blatant argument that it must have been this because it's improbable when there is no really backing for the reverse argument. How do you counteract this? And also, if you have anything to add to this, Christopher.
It is true that one can always, by re-rigging the assumptions, create new probabilities. So for example, there are many physicists who have computed that if you look at all the particles of matter in the entire universe, the chance of them randomly assembling to produce a cell is essentially zero. However, you can increase that probability by adding universes. And there are many cosmologists who say, well, what if there are 1,000 universes or an infinity of universes? Then in the infinity of time, and that's a problematic statement in itself, but with an infinity of universes, an infinity of transactions, even improbable events do occur. The problem with that is you can call it not only a scandalous violation of Occam's razor, it's essentially syllogistic promiscuity. Because what is the evidence that there is even one other universe other than our own? Empirically, none. You're essentially making up universes to account for the anomalies of the universe we have. So which is more likely? It's almost as if the atheist to try to abolish one invisible God has to fabricate an infinity of invisible universes. I mean, I'd like to believe that, but frankly, I don't have that much faith.
The person violating the principle of William of Ockham here, I think, though, Dinesh, is you. I mean, everyone remembers what Laplace said to Napoleon when he produced he was the greatest scientist of his day, his orrery, the solar system, as viewed from the outside, never been done before in model form. And the emperor said, well, there doesn't seem to be any God in this apparatus. And Laplace said, well, Your Majesty, it happens to operate perfectly well without that assumption. So it does. Dinesh asked earlier, and I should have taken him up on it, isn't it the case that to the three questions, where are we from, where are we going, and why are we here, there are three nopes from our side. That's not true at all. It was incredible that he alleged it. So the question of where are we from, both in the macro and the micro term, where did we come from, the cosmological, the Big Bang, and the micro, the unraveling of the human string of DNA and our kinship with other animals and indeed other forms of non-animal life, we are to an enormously greater extent well informed about our origins. And what we don't know, we don't claim to know. Very important. Admitting that I don't know exactly how it began is not at all the same as Dinesh's admission that he doesn't know either. Because he feels he has to know. Because if it's not a matter of faith and it's not a matter of God, he can't say he believes in it a little bit. It must be a real belief to be genuine, and it must have some explanatory value. And he doesn't hold it very strongly, and it doesn't explain anything for which we have better explanations. Likewise about where we are going. We have a very good idea now of the time and place, if you like, the time anyway, when our universe and our sun, and indeed the cosmos, will come to an end. Dinesh might say, well then if you look at the Bible, it proves right all those who said the end of the world is at hand. There's biblical authority. In fact, it just proves we were right all along. Yes, except that they said that by repenting, you could prevent this outcome, which you cannot, ladies and gentlemen. Okay? As to why are we here, good question, to which there's so far no perfect answer, and I suggest you keep the argument about that open and sharpen the questions and consider the infinite possible variety of answers and train your mind that way. Don't say you already know why you're here, that someone wants you to be here, that you're fathered, that you're protected, that it's all part of a divine plan. You can't know that, and you shouldn't say it. There.
I want to get back to the basics of this debate. And Professor D'Souza, you touched on this a little bit using the free will argument. I want to know how you can reconcile your statement that belief is a good thing when so many lives have been lost due to the differing opinions of religious views.
That is a that is true, although historically greatly overstated. The Inquisition. When I was a student at Dartmouth, if you had asked me how many people were killed in the Inquisition, I would have said hundreds of thousands, maybe millions, horrible blot on Western history. Truth of it is, these things are now carefully studied. Henry Kamen has a multi-volume study of the Inquisition. Spanish Inquisition was the worst. And over 350 years, the number of people killed in the Inquisition was fewer than 2,000. Now, 2,000 people, 350 years, it works out to about five guys a year. Not normally considered a world historical crime. Now, is that 2,000 too many? Yes. But my point is that while the atheists are often crying crocodile tears over the crimes of religion, crimes that, by the way, often occurred 500 or 1,000 years ago, what about the vastly greater crimes of atheist regimes committed in our own lifetime in the last century, and they are still going on? If you take Hitler, Stalin, and Mao alone, the three of them collectively in the space of a few decades killed close to 100 million people. And that's the tip of the iceberg. What about Ceausescu, Kim Jong-il, Fidel Castro, Pol Pot? Pol Pot, he's a junior league atheist. Normally you don't even name the guy. But his Khmer Rouge regime in Indochina following the Vietnam War kills about 2 million in about 3 years. 2 million! Even bin Laden in his wildest dreams doesn't even come close. So I'm all for looking at the historical record, but let's look at it fairly and not blame religion for crimes when there are vastly greater and more recent crimes committed by atheist regimes. Let's look at all sides of the ledger.
There's a factual and a theoretical comment to be made on that. First, I think you're flat out wrong on the Inquisition. Not that the numbers game is crucial, but the Inquisition in the Americas caused Father Bartolomeo de las Casas to convene a great meeting at the University of Salamanca to consider whether the Christian world should ever have gone as conquistadors, because the genocidal price paid by the people of old Colombia, pre-Columbia, was so high. Slavery, torture, burning. No one knows what the numbers are, but they're horrifying. The second, the 30 Years' War has to be considered a war of religion, and we don't know how many people were killed there either, but the retarding of civilization was absolutely gigantic, as well as the appalling harvest of innocent population. Third, at the beginning of the First World War, a clash of empires, all of the imperial leaders were, in a sense, theocrats. The Ottoman Empire was a theocracy by definition. Kaiser Wilhelm II was the head of the Protestant Church in Germany. The Tsar of Russia was the head of the Russian Orthodox Church in Russia. The King Emperor of Britain, George V, was the head of the Church of England, as you say, rightly founded on the family values of Henry VIII. civilization has not recovered from the retarding process of that war either. In fact, we never will get over what happened in that war. And those are wars of religion. Just to stay with the point of fact and on the secular, the allegation that the other killers are secular. Of the first one you mentioned, Adolf Hitler, it has to be said that I can almost give you the page reference of Mein Kampf, where he says that his desire to slaughter the Jews is because his fealty to the work of the Lord. He regards it as a holy cause. That's in Mein Kampf. Maybe he doesn't have the authority to say that, but you can't call him secular. On the belt buckle of every Nazi soldier, it read, Gott mit uns, every single one of them, God on our side. Just as the Confederacy had Deo Vindice as its official motto in the Civil War for slavery. It's been calculated by the Catholic historian Paul Johnson that up to one third of the SS were confessing Catholics. If you change the word fascism, if you take it out of the history of the 1930s, just remove it, pretend it doesn't exist, call it a propaganda word, insert instead extreme Christian right wing, you have not to alter, you don't have to alter a thing about the spread of fascism from Portugal through Spain, across to Croatia, to Slovakia, where the head of the Nazi puppet regime was a priest in holy orders, Father Tiso, Vichy, Austria, you know the story, or if you don't, you should. Or anyone here who considers himself a Catholic should know that. This is not, I'm sorry to say, ladies and gentlemen, secularism. Of the others, I would actually say Pol Pot had a very extreme idea of a restoration of the old Buddhist authority known as the Angkor. But let me not quarrel too much. What was wrong with these heroic mass murderers? That they all thought that they could bring about an ultimate history. They all thought that with them, history would be consummated. History would, in fact, come to an end. They were messianic. The whole problem to begin with is the idea that human beings can be perfected by force, or by faith, or by conquest, or by inquisition. That can take an explicitly religious form or just another messianic form, but it reinforces the point I began with. Take nothing for certain. Don't believe in any absolutism. Don't believe in any totalitarianism. Don't ask for any supreme leader in the sky or on earth, for that way lies madness and torture and murder, and always will.
May I answer briefly, just given the nature of the topic? Let me say very briefly, first of all, Las Casas was not protesting the work of the Inquisition. He was protesting the work of the conquistadors. There's a big difference between the Spaniards who came for greed and gold and to take slaves, and the church. Which sent missionaries. The missionaries were on the side of the Indians and convened the debate at Salamanca at which the Pope decided that the Indians have souls and that the Spanish conquest should be stopped. Never in human history, by the way, has a ruler ordered a conquest stopped for moral reasons, and it was the missionaries who made that argument. So factually, it is not true that the deaths of the Indians, most of which, by the way, were through malaria and other diseases to which they had no immunities, but it had nothing to do with the missionaries. It was driven by the greed of the conquistadors. The 30 Years' War. Look at the history of the 30 Years' War, and you'll see, look at the alliances. If they broke down neatly into Catholic versus Protestant, you could say perhaps it's a religious war, but they didn't. Catholic France began to ally with the Protestants the moment that the Protestants began to lose. Right away, you see that territorial wars over power and land are now being presented as wars of religion. Was World War I a religious war? That would make every war a religious war. World War II was a religious war. In other words, just because France is Catholic and England is Protestant doesn't make it a religious war if they're fighting over territory. Hitler. Now, here we have to be a little careful, because in Mein Kampf, yes, Hitler has a long section on propaganda in which he says, do not be afraid to lie to make your case. There is a book edited by the distinguished historian Hugh Trevor Roper called Hitler's Table Talk. It gives detailed accounts assembled by Martin Boring himself of Hitler's views on a wide range of subjects. Hitler hated Christianity. He was not a religious believer. He might have been some sort of a Teutonic pagan. He might have believed a weird form of ancient polytheism, but no recognizable form of monotheism, and he detested Christianity.
Not secular.
I'm doing the Lord's work was tactical. He wanted the support of the Bavarian Catholics and the Lutheran Protestants, and so he invented what he called the Arian Christ, the Christ who comes back to avenge himself on the Jews. The churches didn't go for it. So this is a complex history. I've written about it myself. The bottom line of it is, my point isn't that Hitler was an atheist, but that the 20th century saw secular regimes which tried to get rid of traditional religion and morality and establish a new man and a new utopia, the secular paradise. And look what it brought us, an ocean of blood, a mountain of bodies. So but for this reason, I'm concluding that it is this effort to enforce secular utopia and not religion that is responsible for the mass murders of history.
You can reply quickly if you like, and then we'll go back to questions. I'm going to let the questions go about 8 minutes over time because we started late, and then we'll wrap up.
No, I should be quick. In that case, Dinesh, you gracefully withdraw the allegation that National Socialism and Fascism were secular or atheistic, and I'm grateful for your generosity. Second, that people change sides in religious wars for opportunist reasons doesn't particularly surprise me. You can spend a lot of time telling a Protestant in Northern Ireland who has a picture of King William painted on the side of his house that when King William fought the Battle of the Boyne, his ally was the Pope. The Protestant sort of knows this, the Ulster Protestant, but he doesn't really believe it's true, happens to be true. Of course it's opportunistic. Why is it opportunistic? Because religion is man-made, as I began by saying. It's what you would expect if religion was the creation of aggressive, fearful primates. It's exactly what you would expect. And the same would be true of its non-religious attempts to create paradise, because it's asking too much of people, and it leads to fanaticism and torture and murder and war. So all you succeed in doing is replacing the question. No, there's no teleology. No, there's no eschatology. No, there's no ultimate history. No, there's no redemption. No, there are no supreme leaders here or anywhere else. Thank you.
Thank you both for the thought-provoking ideas that you've presented. I have questions about the scientific things that you mentioned. One was sort of raised earlier. You mentioned the cell as this complex thing, as if it is theorized that it arose spontaneously. And I may be out of date, but I remember reading theories at some points about more chemical molecules that began reproducing much before any actual cells. And wouldn't that be an explanation of earlier life? And the second one has to do with the perfectly tuned universe and whether the logic of saying that life exists that fits this perfectly tuned universe is an indication of that somehow divinely created fits with the idea that there's evolution, and that if the universe is tuned in a certain way, that the only possibility of life with that tuning is life as it exists now. And perhaps it would be presumptuous of us to say that if it were tuned differently, there wouldn't be some other way that different forms of life would have arisen.
Let me address those points in sequence. With regard to the cell, Darwin speculated that it might have come about in a warm pond. In the 1950s, there were some experiments that generated some amino acids, and there was a lot of excitement thinking that there might be a way to recreate in the laboratory the ingredients of life. Those experiments haven't gone anywhere, but more importantly, that in the real world wasn't a laboratory. Even if you could recreate the ingredients in a laboratory using all the laboratory apparatus, it doesn't mean it happened. You have to show that it could have happened that way in nature. So the point I'm simply saying is, based on current knowledge, and all arguments have to be based on what we know now. We're all open to new ideas in the future. There is currently no good explanation. And all I'm saying is that in any other sphere of life, if I was walking down and look in an alley and I see a head rolling around, I conclude that somebody committed suicide or somebody killed someone. It's a reasonable inference from the data. You could say, well, that's a rather presumptuous conclusion. There might have been natural ways in which the head detached itself from the... There could be, but what's the most plausible under the circumstances? Normally, when we see intelligent activity, what is science but an effort to excavate intelligence out of nature? The reason we need Newton and Einstein is because intelligence is hidden in nature. E equals MC squared doesn't jump out at you. You've got to test nature and pull it out. So if nature is an embodiment, a network of intelligent systems, isn't the most reasonable explanation that intelligence put it there? If we need intelligence to get it out, how to get there in the first place? This seems to me to be nothing more than a direct inference from the facts. Now, I want to say a word about Larry Krauss, who was mentioned earlier, the physicist. The universe coming out of nothing. There's a lot of verbal jugglery that's going into all this. Imagine if I were to try to show the following. Money comes out of nothing. Proof? All assets will be counted as plus. All liabilities will be counted as minus. The pluses and minus cancel out. We have money, but there's a zero on the balance sheet. Money comes out of nothing. You would say this is a little bit sleight of hand. Basically, what's going on today is what physicists like Krauss do is they identify all energy as positive, but all gravitational energy as negative. They presume that the total amount of positive and negative energy cancels out, and therefore the universe came out of nothing. It didn't really come out of nothing. There's a whole lot of energy there, but by defining one kind of energy as plus and another kind of energy as minus, presto, they cancel out, and you've got... So what I'm getting at here is I want to show the acrobatics to which modern atheism has to go. This, by the way, is not science. Krauss is trying to make an atheist argument in an atheist venue drawing on science. But I'm saying, look at the lengths to which the guy has to go to try to defy the normal operations of reason to tell us that not only a molecule, but an entire universe, wow, popped out of absolutely nothing. You can believe it if you want to, but it sure does take a lot of credulity.
I'll try and be terse, but first, I earnestly entreat you, ladies and gentlemen, to watch Professor Krauss's lecture for yourself and not accept that parodic version of it. On the nothing question, as it touches on ourselves, as it happens, it's rather more marvelous than almost anything in any holy book. All the elements from which we and our surroundings are made are from exploded stars, from the stars that blow up and die at the rate of one every second and have been doing that since the Big Bang. Isn't it rather magical to think that we're all made out of stardust? Never mind, as Professor Krauss says, never mind the martyrs. Stars had to die so that we could live. This is a very essential reflection to be having, and it dwarfs the religious explanations. You didn't notice, Dinesh, that the gentleman asked at the end, couldn't it have turned out another way, which I think was possibly the crux of his question. I'd recommend another study to you. Professor Stephen Jay Gould, who I mentioned flatteringly earlier, in spite of my disagreement with him about the non-overlapping magisteria, did a marvelous paleontological book called The Burgess Shale. This is a half of a mountain that's fallen away in the Canadian Rockies, revealing the whole interior core of a great mountain. So you can read off as if on a screen, it's more like a bush actually than a tree, all the little tendrils of evolution of reptiles, birds, plants, and so on, as they sprout up, branch off. And many of them stop, nothing happened to them. They were quite promising, but they went nowhere. And it doesn't go up like a tree, it goes all over the place like a bush. Well, says Professor Gould, it's one of the most unsettling, vertiginous thoughts I've ever heard from a paleontologist. Suppose that we could, which in a way we can, rewind this as if onto a tape, get the Burgess Shale, get the outlines of the book, rewind it, play it again. There's absolutely no certainty it would come out the same way, that all those branches would go off and diverge and die out or flourish in the way that they do as they did. It's completely governed by uncertainty. There are any number of conceivable outcomes up with which evolution could have come. It's another version of our selfishness, our self-regard, I might say, our solipsism, that we cannot easily unconvince ourselves that all of this happened so that the Pope could condemn masturbation.
If I can offer a very, very brief rebuttal, we're now plumbing into the depths here a little bit. I do want to point out that Gould's thesis, rewind the tape of life and it would come out differently, which is by now a few decades old, is challenged by the world's leading expert in the Burgess Shale, Simon Conway Morris, a paleontologist in England, and also by Christian de Duve, a Nobel laureate in chemistry. And their argument is no, that essentially Gould had it wrong. Gould was guessing that every evolutionary pathway would cut very differently. But the latest evidence is that that's not so. Consider the evolution of the eye. For a long time, in a sense, 6,000-year creationists would say, how could the eye evolve? Turns out that the eye has evolved multiple times, and it's evolved in similar ways. That is telling us that evolution is not this random thicket. It tends to converge to solutions that are similar, even when faced with different kind of organisms and different kind of problems. So I recommend to you not only Conway Morris and DeDuve, but also a book called Rare Earth by the paleontologist Brownlee, which basically looks at why we haven't found life on other planets, rare earth. And their conclusion is that the conditions for life to exist are so particular that it's actually reasonable to expect that life exists only here, only on this planet. It seems almost incredible, but when you think about it, it actually makes sense. Consider this. Our life is completely dependent on the sun. The sun is eight...
This is more than brief.
Oh, you're right. I'm being carried away, so I'll stop here and we'll go to the next question.
Do you have a very brief reply?
It's so nice that, and how much we progress. No one now argues against the evolution of the eye. Now the argument of the evolution of the eye is completely conceded, and then it's used against Stephen Jay Gould. The thing to read there is Richard Dawkins's chapter on the multiple evolutions of the eye, including the fish that have four, is to be found in Climbing Mount Improbable, to which I also recommend you. As for, I agree with you that it's very overwhelmingly likely that our planet is the only one that supports life. Certainly, we know in our own little suburb of the solar system that all the other planets don't support life. They're either much too hot or much too cold, as are large tracts of our planet, and we have every reason to know now that we live on a climatic knife edge, and in the meantime, our sun is preparing to blow up and become a red dwarf. I ask you, whose design is that?
We will take one more question. I'm going to ask each of our speakers to let their reply to this question also double as their closing remarks.
Now I feel bad, though.
It better be
choose
a great
well,
one.
Man.
Okay.
Tread softly, for you tread on our dreams.
My question is for Mr. Dinesh. You talked before about, well, the improbability of a lot of things, and given the improbability, the necessary meaning of certain things. So because of the improbability of life in some circumstances, because of the uniqueness of life here, that this implies something. How would you respond to the thought that maybe there doesn't have to be any meaning? That, say, as existentialists would say, there's no inherent meaning, but we can create our own meaning. So I guess my question is, why must there be some inherent purpose or some trajectory? Why can't things have just happened, albeit maybe very improbably?
I think that you misunderstand my argument if it is an inference to meaning. I'm not saying we have improbable events, we've got to figure out some kind of meaning. No, I'm making inference to a cause. David Hume, the great skeptic, said there is no event that occurs without a cause. Now, true, in the weird world of the quantum, we can find exceptions to that rule. But quantum effects cancel out when you come to macroscopic objects. And whenever you hear someone say, consciousness, I really don't know what that is, but perhaps it's a quantum thing, he's basically saying he doesn't know. The quantum is invoked to explain things that are unexplained. Here's my point. Here's the argument tightened up. Everything that has a beginning, all material objects that have a beginning, have a cause. The universe is a material object that has a beginning. The universe has a cause. The cause could be natural or supernatural. The cause cannot be natural because nature can't cause itself, unless Professor Krauss is right. Since the cause can't be natural, it's more believable that a supernatural being, and moreover a supernatural being with a lot of power and a lot of knowledge and a lot of concern for us, because life is the outcome of this process, these are reasonable inferences to a cause. I mentioned earlier the three big questions. Christopher said science has provided answers, and he restated all my three questions. So none of them were my original questions. So for example, when I said, where are we going? My point was, what happens after we die? Is there life after death? We don't know. The atheist doesn't know, the believer doesn't know. The atheist who says there isn't, just like the believer who says there is making a leap of faith. Christopher avoided the question by changing it to, will the universe come to an end? Will the sun blow up? That wasn't my point. My point is what happens to us after we die. That is unknown. Science has no insight on that question. And here's a final thought. Very often we use evolution as a catch-all explanation, but we don't subject evolution to the critical scrutiny that we subject religion. For example, Christopher invoked earlier, and it's been repeatedly invoked, Freud's idea that we invent the afterlife because we want to live forever. We're upset with life, we have suffering, we have death, we imagine another world that's better. No suffering, no death, heaven. Now, the only problem with this, first of all, is that religions not only posit heaven, they also posit hell. And if you're going to make up another world to compensate for the difficulties in this one, it's very odd that you would make up hell. Hell's a lot worse than diabetes, or even death, because death is just turning off the computer. But there's an evolutionary argument against this that has now discredited the Freudian explanation. And what is that? Evolution says that we are creatures programmed to survive and reproduce. It is very costly for us to invent schemes that are not true and to invest costly resources, especially for primitive man, to give money to priests, to build cathedrals and pyramids, to invest in the next life. Evolution ruthlessly punishes that kind of extravagance. And that's why this Freudian theory, which was very fashionable 60 years ago, has fallen into disrepute among scholars. It makes no evolutionary sense. So the bottom line I'm getting at here is, in a debate like this, I've been very pleased with this debate. I think it has been actually at a higher level than a lot of debates on this kind of a topic, and even some of our debates. I think we've been able to raise it to another level. Ultimately, I think I want to show that the believer's position, no less than the atheist's, is an attempt to grapple with the facts, to make sense of the data, to illuminate rationally the world that we live in. Faith is not a substitute for reason. Faith only kicks in when reason comes to an end, when there are explanations and they stop. I date my wife for 3 years. I then want to decide if I should propose. I put in reason. I try to see where it goes. But then I say, what is life with her going to be like for the next 50 years? And there's no way to know. I can say, well, I'm going to be an agnostic. I'm going to wait for the data to come in. Well, if I do that, she'll marry someone else, so we'll both be dead. The data will never be in. At some point, rational knowledge has to give way to practical action. And faith is the bridge between limited, always limited human knowledge and the inevitability and necessity of human action. That ultimately is something that knowledge can teach us. Thank you very much.
Well, if I'm not mistaken, that was a meaning of life question there, wasn't it? Wherefore and whence forth meaning. Good, a good way of winding up, if you like.
42. The paper's got to be the galaxy.
I missed something there. It went past my bat. And slightly put me off my stroke as well. Just a second. Where was it? Yes, meaning. But before I go to that, just two things on Dinesh. In his last remarks, I don't think it can fairly be said in front of an audience like this that the refusal to take a faith-based position that has no evidence, in other words, a belief that there is an afterlife or a belief that there is a supreme being, if I say I don't believe it because there's no evidence for it, it isn't even casuistry to say that that is, on my part, a faith-based statement. It's instead a refusal of faith and a refusal to use it as a method of reasoning. So it's not comparing like with like at all. Second, not just completely to defend Sigmund Freud, Dinesh is right in criticizing Freud's Future of an Illusion to the extent that when people are subject to wish thinking, we might expect them to be purely hedonistic, only to want the best, to say, let's imagine a comforting future while we are about it, something that will cheer us all up. As a matter of fact, we're not as nice as all that. We don't want everyone going to hell. Excuse me, we don't want everyone going to heaven. As the old English sect used to say, we are the pure and chosen few, and all the rest are damned. There's room enough in hell for you. We don't want heaven crammed. And the great existentialist Jean-Paul Sartre said that hell is other people, but actually what many people mean is hell is for other people. And they have just as strong a wish thought that other people suffer eternally as they have the thought and the wish for themselves that they should be in paradise. You can see it very explicitly when you see other versions of the paradise myth, like the Muslim one, or early Christian versions, where part of the pleasure of being in heaven was knowing that other people were burning forever. And that's what you'd expect of a predatory, fearful, partly evolved primate species that was making up a religious story about itself. It sounds exactly as you would expect it to do. All right, well, believing in none of that, in fact, thinking it's an evil and futile belief, people have the nerve to ask me, well, if you don't believe in heaven and hell, what gives your life meaning? Do you not detect a slight insult as well as a slight irrationality to that question? You mean I'd have much more meaning in my life if I thought that I would die and I'd be given one chance, would have been given while I was alive, one chance, and if I'd made a mistake, I'd be condemned eternally, that was the kind of judge I'd be facing. And in the meantime, it would be advisable to live my life in propitiation of this supernatural dictator. That would lend more meaning to my life than my view counter to Pascal, contra Pascal, that if there's any such judge, I'll be able to say, at least I never faked belief in you in order to win your approbation, sir, or ma'am, as the case might be. And if you are as reported, you'll have detected that those were my thoughts, and at least I wasn't a hypocrite. Pascal says, no, at least pretend you believe. It's win-win. This is corrupt reasoning. It's the reasoning of a huckster. And it lends no meaning to life at all. Still, why do I care? For example, why do I care? Why do I care about Rwanda? Why do I care about my Iranian friends fighting theocracy? Why do I give up my own time to them? Well, I'll tell you why, I suppose at the risk of embarrassment. It gives me great pleasure to do so. I like to feel that since we only have one life to live, that I can help people make it free as best I can, and assist them in their real struggle for liberty, which in its most essential form is the struggle against theocracy, which is the original form that dictatorship and violation of human rights actually takes. I enjoy doing it, and I enjoy the sort of people it makes me come in contact with. And I like giving blood. Passively, I mean. I don't like spilling it, but I don't mind having it run off me in a pint, because it's, strangely enough, it's a pleasurable sensation. And you know that someone else is getting a pint of blood, and you aren't losing one, because with a strong cup of tea or Bloody Mary, you'll get it back, or both, you'll get it back. So it used to appeal to me in my old socialist days. It's the perfect model for human solidarity. It's in your interest to do it, someone else benefits, you don't lose, and if, like me, you have a rare blood group, you hope that other people do the same thing so there's enough blood when your own turn comes. And it's an all-round agreeable experience, and it's not like being fearful of judgment. It's much more meaningful than that. I think it's often believed of people like myself that there's something joyless in our view. Where is the role in the atheist world, the unbelieving world, for the numinous, or the ecstatic, or the transcendent? Well, come on, those of us who can appreciate poetry and music and love and friendship and solidarity are not to be treated as if we have no imagination, as if we have no moral or emotional pulse, as if we don't feel things at nightfall when music plays and friends are around, as if we don't get great pleasure when we meet. We don't meet to repeat incantations we've had dinned into us since childhood. We don't feel so insecure that we must incant and recite and go through routine and ritual. We meet to discuss our differences and to discuss the latest challenges to our worldview from people like Dinesh. We try and use the method of the Socratic dialogue even when its conclusions are unwelcome to ourselves. And though, therefore, I can't recommend atheism as morally superior, I can say that at least it faces the consequences of its belief with a certain stoicism. We might wish for eternal life, but we're not going to award it to ourselves as a prize for work we haven't yet done. So my closing recommendation is, why not try the stoical and Socratic life for yourself? Why not examine more closely the tradition, the great tradition that we have from Lucretius and Democritus that goes through Galileo, Spinoza, Voltaire, Einstein, Russell, and many others. A tradition, I think, much greater than the fearful and the propitiatory and the ritualistic. I've been enormously grateful for your kindness in having me here. I want to thank you again. Good night.